reminder, but still. So there are some connecting graphs. And then for every cell, we have a number in C with the property that if we kept one diagonal fixed, then this map was unitary time scalar, and if we kept the other diagonal fixed, then the same was happening. Yes, yes. Well, wait. So, not quite. I mean, no, definitely not. So, what we showed, let me mention, and we'll count those things just in a minute. So, there is a very important gauge, which is a freedom of choice, which was whenever you had on the auxiliary graph, whenever you had here k edges, then the gauge was a UK. So you could change all the cells with a UK. And very good. And what we showed was that if you have the graph AN here, and I think we used the graph D4, but the proof worked in general. So if you have the graph AN on one side, so if this was a graph AN and this was any graph here ADE, then and if you specify a vertex A, there was a unique connection of this kind. So this was called a connection or a Q-map between the graphs. There was a unique connection up to gauge with one edge, with one distinguished edge from zero here to A. So first of all, I would like to mention, let me lift the screen here. I would like to mention what we obtain this way. What we obtain this way is that we have now a model. So if we map AN into AN, we're going to map 0 into the vertex V, into the vertex K. In this case, so this is, this corresponds exactly to the the spin k over 2 for the irreducible representations of SU2 at the nth root of 1. Quantum SU2, yes, of quantum SU2 at the, well, when I specify that it's at some root of unity. So if you are asked to produce an actual representation of quantum SU2 which tensors correctly, the product of two things is correct and it decomposes using unitaries, Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, and so on. If you are asked to produce such a thing for the ninth grade, not quite, but for high schoolers who learned what a unitary is, maybe, I mean, you don't even need a unitary because the connection here is real, these are concrete objects which are doing that. So what I mean, let's see, in this case, if we connect 0 to k, so this is 0 in the graph to k, to the vertex k of in An, in the vertices of An, then the vertex L here is going to connect precisely to L, well, if you to various M's, so sigma M over 2, so sigma M is contained in sigma k tensor sigma l, and sigma k is a spin k over 2, or degree k. So let me show you some, let me show you exactly how these connect. So this contains a fusion, and let me bring down the screen. So remember, what you're going to see is, if you have a graph AN, that's what we did last time, so this is a graph AN, you see here where things connect, yes? And with what multiplicity. So here, this was for the graph D, if you remember, this was with multiplicity 2, these are yellow edges. It's a double one, and this was one. Again, simple edges. And this was, so this is the graph. The graph here was D4. Yes, and this was D4, and D4 inverse, and D4, and D4 inverse. Yes. So notice that, once again, those numbers indicate exactly that. Now let's look here for the graphs AN. These are the graphs AN. We have only a few of them here. So look, if we start from 1, from the vertex, so if we, the top vertex is a starting vertex, so if we connect AN to AN, we get the identity, right? If we connect AN to the second vertex, do you see you get the vertex before and the vertex after? So here the graph is AN, it looks like this, and this is the AN here. And let's say that you connect to this vertex, UA, so we're going to connect it here, and in that case, the graph that you're going to get is something like this, a rectangle full of ones, one, 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 and so on. Lots of ones here in this rectangle, and this is exactly the fusion, and the rest is zero. This is exactly the fusion with, if this vertex is k, so in this case 0, 1, k is equal to 2, fusion with sigma 2. The spin 1 representation. Do you recognize here this is tensoring with the spin 1? You get the previous one and the next one. Can you see? Yes? Look for every vertex here, so you get, if you are on this position, which corresponds to the middle, you get the previous and the next one. Yes, so if you write the graph of tensoring, just like in second grade, you write it as a table, a nice table here. So you have here tensoring with sigma k. And k is double the degree, double the spin, or the degree, yes? And if you take here L, you're going to have L minus k plus 1 up to L plus k minus 1 if k is less than L. Yes, so this would be here for the multiplication, yes? And if you draw them, then you're going to get exactly the picture there, yes? The middle one is the tensoring with the real one, with sigma, with spin 1. That's a dimension, so I use here the dimension because we use them as polynomials, yes. By the way, the spin for mathematicians, yes, the spin can be interpreted as spinning. So if you turn your head to the left, yes, and open your eyes, you'll find the rest of the world turned to the right, yes? So it means that in your head you have a model which spins backwards with respect to your movement at a rate of 1 times 1, 1 to 1, yes? So that is taken to be spin 1. So the particles have a little vector space which does exactly like this model in your head at every point. However, it may spin only half that fast. So you may need to spin, as I was showing you with Dirac's belt, you may need to spin 4 pi to get to the same point, yes? So this is half compared to the usual spinning, yes? The usual one is taken, the norm is taken to be the real representation of SU2, which is three-dimensional on R3, yes? Very good. Any questions here? So what I mean by that is that if you take the tensoring and if you compose the maps that we described last time, and if you find the unitaries which break sigma k composed with sigma l into indecomposables, then those should give you the Clebsch-Gordan coefficients for the representations of SL2 at the root of unity. So we have done these, we have a concrete model for them, yes.
Yeah.
So here, right. So what a good conceptual thing is always a good idea. So here's what happens. Remember that when we computed essential path, we took linear combinations of paths, and let me write it here as an example. So this was plus, minus, so this is for the thing in the middle there, minus, and then you have, so, and then you have things like this, then things like this, and then a path like this, and finally this one. Yes, and you take this one with sine plus, this one with minus, since this is minus, this will be plus. Since this is plus, this one must be minus. And this one must be plus, and this one will be minus. So you take the sum of these paths, yes? These paths have the following property, that if you contract, so contract, any two adjacent edges, any two adjacent levels. Yes, what happens if you contract the top? This one would be zero because these two edges are not the same. Yes? This one would be minus this, yes? You see, we contract these two. Yes, we get, and the coefficient was minus one. So we get minus this. Then we contract these two, we get plus this. Do you see? When we contract these two, yes? Then we get plus that, minus that, and then we get minus zero, yes? And the grand total is zero. So these paths have the property that if you contract two adjacent floors, they give you zero, yes? Now, the trivial irreducible representation of SU2 is one in, and is contained in sigma 1 tensor, so sigma 0, which is the identity, in sigma 1 tensor sigma 1. Yes? So this is a contraction. The contraction should really be oriented with a half blob, but the results are the same. So this is a map, if you remember, which was sending E1 tensor E2 into 1/2, E2 tensor E1 into negative 1/2, and the rest in zero. Yes? So this contraction. So what we have asked is that with this, now you see if you contract in general, if you have any kind of contraction, and the rest are just going along. So this is a shorter path, shorter path. Yes? So you have here a path. You contract two levels, two adjacent levels. This indicates exactly what you do. You take an edge, you put it backwards, and you take the Kronecker symbol, yes? So if you contract these two, you'll get a shorter path, yes? Yeah, so that shorter path means a shorter tensor product of, so this corresponds to shorter tensor product of generators. of SU2. Yes?
Sorry, could you draw a specific path and say how to translate?
Sure, here. Exactly. These are, for instance, such paths. Yes? So we have this. Yes. So the edges of the graph AN. Yes? So edges of AN are tensoring with sigma 1, which is a spin 1/2. This is the, it's a Cayley graph. Of tensoring, you tensor and you split into pieces, yes? So, do you see here, these are used, so this is, these are used in both directions. So if you tensor, this is a trivial representation. If you tensor with a generator, you get the spin half, yes? If you take this spin half, you tensor with a generator, you get the two neighbors, yes? And so on. So this is a graph of tensoring with sigma. So let me lift the blackboard. And yes, actually, this is the first time, but it gets it in a very canonical way. You're right. What we're going to use are the essential path, but the actual maps, remember those phi maps, yes? Those are concrete maps, and those compose exactly as I say. Yes, but by and large, you're absolutely right. So what we're going to use it most is with essential paths. So I introduced the essential paths in the 1980s or so, and I found that now that it's much nicer to get, for instance, all these coefficients, you see, which depend on the whole path, to get them out of a single unit, out of a unitary. Yes. Yes, let me just write now the definition. I was just arriving at that. So remember, edge, so this is a dictionary. Edge is dot tensor generator. The edge corresponds to tensoring with a generator, yes? Path of length n, path of length k, corresponds to tensoring. You see, you put edge after edge after edge, yes? So this means that you tensor with sigma 1 to the tensor power k. And essential path of length k corresponds precisely to tensoring with sigma k, which is the highest weight irreducible of SU2 in the generator to the tensor power k. So 100 years ago, Hermann Weyl found the amazing property of the best behaved groups with respect to representation theory. First of all, that groups well behaved with respect to representation theory should start by behaving well with respect to themselves, which means that the adjoint, the action on themselves, should be non-degenerate. And once that happens, what he found was that there were some generators. These generators were put later exactly on the vertices of the graph, of the Dynkin diagram. So they are the duals of the simple roots. So there are some generators. And you can get any irreducible by tensoring generators in any amount. So E8 has, the graph E8 is a graph of a Lie group, has 8 generators. You can tensor a number of times the first one, a number of times the second one, and so on. Yes? And in that big tensor product, there is one highest weight irreducible. Now, this irreducible has a property that it has not appeared earlier. Yes? Which is exactly what we have on the blackboard. Look here, we have a shorter path. So if we take here the irreducible, it cannot have appeared in the shorter path. Yes? That is why the contraction is zero. So this essential path realized exactly in a concrete way with graphs, Hermann Weyl's program. And they generalize to everything. So this is what we do over SU2. Over SU3, we'll also make sure that whatever linear combinations of paths we use, they were not contained in shorter path. Yes? So anything that would shorten the tensor product should give you zero. Then you are sure that you have the highest weight irreducible. Well, it's just separating the irreducible. So it certainly is very useful exactly where you use representations in all places, because it separates the irreducible. So instead of tensoring with a generator many times, you just take the irreducible, yes? So now let us continue here. And let us discuss a little bit the connection exactly with the classical quiver theory. Remember that what we had was a representation, I think. Let's put now the arrows upwards. You'll see why in a minute. So you have an oriented graph, and our example was D4, if you remember. Yes? And we had here some dimensions, 1, 1, 1, and 2. And the picture that we had was R2 here and three lines. So this was R1, R1, R1 was mapping to this R2. Yes, it's three lines. And these three lines, there was no freedom. We could choose two of them orthogonal, and then we could adjust the basis. So the third was at 45 degrees. It's a beautiful thing because very simply it represents a graph. There are only finitely many irreducibles, but it looks kind of ad hoc. The angles are all wrong and so on. Yes, now let's look at what we do with the essential path. So these are the essential paths on the graph D4, which we have just computed. Remember that these were exactly the images of the graph AN. And we're going to take, so this was a graph AN, here it was A5, into our graph D4. Yes, and the images were computed by using exactly this statistical mechanical strip. So we put here the edge 0 up to k, And then we took all the paths with the coefficient given by these cells. Yes? So up to k. And now we're going to go up to length 4 here, and you can check that these are the unique essential path. So this is plus, minus. Ah, this one does not work. Why doesn't it work? Can you check? If you make a contraction here, there's nothing to cancel it. Can you see? If you contract here, this is on the graph D4. Yes? There's nothing to cancel it with. So the essential path here are this plus and minus. The first one, the second one for this part is plus minus, and for the third vertex it's plus and minus. Yes, these are the three essential paths. This is here 1, 1, and 1. Yes? And up to here, it's 2. This was a two-dimensional space. So up to the middle, you have some two-dimensional space. And now...
You're making a claim that the numbers that we added up are actually counting the number of essential paths.
Essential path from the top, exactly. So there's one of length 0. Yes, that was in fact the definition. We started from the top and we almost a definition. I mean, here the fact that the essential comes from the fact that if you sum these two things together, then there are two different rows of a unitary.
So under your dictionary.
Yes. So D4, wonderful question. So D4 appears here as a quantum subgroup of, or let's put it not subgroup, let's put a module of AN, yes, of SU2. You tensor the top of the D. So there's an irreducible here. You see, this is our alpha. And we tensor
alpha tensor sigma k,
exactly. Alpha tensor sigma k. And this decomposes into the essential path. Yes? Wonderful. Now, do you see here, if we have a longer path, how can we make it shorter? Speaking like a physicist, if you have something and you want to make it disappear, yes, you annihilate. So you're going to annihilate with this edge. With the edges, with these edges. Yes? So you take this sum of paths, you annihilate with this edge, which means simply you take the Kronecker symbol and you throw it away. Yes? And what you're going to get by annihilation are these. And this here, there may be, yes, out of these three things, Yes? Right. And you get these are linearly dependent. So these are exactly in the space up to here, which was two dimensional. You just take a path and you check whether the edge coincides with the edge with which you annihilate. So in linear algebra, that is a partial trace.
So if I were to pick like this edge,
yes,
that would
yeah, hold it up. If you hold up the edge now that you mentioned it, so now a bit closer to me. So if you annihilate with this edge, and if you have a path that doesn't use this edge, it gives you zero, yes? And if you have a path which does use this edge, you just remove that edge.
So the three things you drew were the result of taking all three of those and applying
three different annihilations. So these are exactly the maps of quiver theory. These are exactly the maps from here, and from here into this 2D, one dimensional. So the net result is the following, that we can write it as a theorem. Any AD quiver indecomposable representation is canonically obtained by essential paths from a vertex V. So here's a statement. So here we had the vertex V. The example was this. You had here this vertex V. Our graph was this one. This was where we put our graph D4. Remember, edges oriented upwards. You take a point here, and you find that you have two essential paths. So this is dimension of essential path. It was 2, 1, 1, 1. Yes? Right? And look, we took that one, the one-dimensional things, they were generated exactly by those paths. We annihilated them, so the maps are done by annihilation. Recall that a quiver representation meant that you take a graph, and you put here vector spaces for every I. For every I, you map it into VI, a vector space. And so that the edge, for any edge E from I to J, you had a map from VI to VJ. Yes? And what I am saying is that these spaces VI are canonically essential paths. And this map is annihilation. Yes. Yeah. Well, if you had another edge, let's take here another orientation. So if you had, for instance, this orientation, let's say also d4, two go in and one goes out, yes? In this case, we have to put the arrows upwards, so we're going to orient the two like this, 1, 2, 3, yes? So this is our graph D4. Make sure that there are the three different vertices. Yes. So this was our graph D4. Yes. And then there's a place from which we can, if we have dimensions 1, 1, 2, and 1, yes, there's a place from which we have 2. And you can see that it's exactly the same graph here, coincidentally. So from here, you have 2 essential paths here. 1 here, 1 and 1, yes? And now you simply do annihilation here, annihilation from the 2, so you'll get a two-dimensional space, which has 2 lines in it, and it gets mapped into a line. So the third appears as a kernel. Yes, and you see it's entirely canonical. So here's we have, unfortunately, just 1 minute for the proof. Now, William assured me that the usual quiver representation theory takes 1 semester, so we'll try to compress it very fast. I have 10 minutes, but I want to use them for something else as well. So here's the idea of the proof. Yes, is of proof. This is a proof of the correspondence with the quivers, which, as you'll see, will dispense of entirely. But the idea of the proof, nevertheless, is the following. You have an operation. If you have, for instance, V1, V2, up to VK, and they all get mapped into a space V, these are linear maps. Yes? Then you can take the, then you can reverse the arrows. So this is a principle. Think you can go from V1, V2, VK. Let me choose a simpler of the two. So there's a V tilde which maps into all of them. And conversely, if you have one which maps, I think the simpler one is from below up. Yes. So if you have V which maps into let's see, if you have V1, V2, VK, which maps into V, then you can take V1 plus V2 plus VK, which maps into V, and now you can take the kernel. You can take the kernel of this map, yes? And in this case, the kernel will, so this V tilde is, in this case, a kernel of the of this particular map, and the kernel has components. Ith component. Yes, and there's a linear dual map to this. You should take a course in quiver theory, reserve yourself 1 semester, maybe not, but now what we have here is the following. Look, do you see here we have arrows, 3 arrows going into it, yes? Right? So if we have arrows going into a vertex, we can go to this So move your point move vertex to below so the rest of the graph can be anything but if you have one vertex into which all the arrows go yes so everything is going up then you can move and this way the graph will be oriented you see around this point the opposite way and this map will do exactly what the map in quiver representation theory is supposed to do yes and conversely if you have the things all going up you can move the thing up and go like that and you see now if you want to figure out how to prove that something is irreducible. Yes, the proof is basically this one. So what you do is you take a vector with many components, many non-zero components, yes? So this is a basis. You take a vector with many, many non-zero components. Then you apply some operation that pushes that vector, which pushes that vector into a corner. Yes? So then you push it, push to a corner. This corner is variously called something like the highest weight and so on. Yes? Then just before this is tipped over, you see I stopped carefully here, just before the last component is tipped over, you have a pure form of that vector, yes? It's in that corner. And then very carefully, you start from this corner and you push it back to any vector. Yes, so you need some operators which move it back into an arbitrary vector. Now, once you complete this, you have proved that you can send any vector into any other vector, yes? These are the two steps. And in this particular case, you can lift the graph until you arrive at the vertex V. Now, let me use the last 5 minutes to tell you, so the reason, first of all, the reason why we won't need this at all huh. So we did use today a lot of chalk and blackboard. Yes, the reason why, what's that? Yes, representation theory is has lots of arrows and so, but remember that we pledged in this course not to use any commutative diagram whatsoever, do all the algebra without the algebra. So now here's what happens. You see, the statement is the following, that if you have any quiver, you orient here your quiver, and then there is some point on that list. So there is some point P, which gives you as essential path exactly the indecomposable representations of this quiver. Yes? And moreover, there's another thing. Here you have to guess it fast. What if you have another Q which gives you another representation? What would be a nice map and from which of them to which of them? And built using what physical idea? from one of the representations to another. Exactly, remember what you did here. You used here annihilation, right? With an edge going upwards, yes? Now what can you do on the other end? Nope. Let's try again. We still need a map. Creation is, creation might be something, but yeah, we'll use that. But it's not the case here for the maps. Since we had already a linear map by annihilation, yes? The path has how many ends? A path. Exactly. So you annihilate from the other end. So you take here an essential annihilate with essential path P to Q to get a map of representations from P to Q. Yes? So you annihilate with an edge here or with an essential path. Yes? Obviously, one annihilation will commute with the other because they are the two opposite edges of a path, two distinct edges. So this commutes with lower annihilation. So, since all the indecomposables are given by vertices, yes, via essential paths, and so all indecomposables representations of quivers, yes, are coming from points, and all the maps are coming from representations of quivers. Yes, all maps are coming from essential path. The only redundant thing in this whole thing now are the since every representation comes from a point and every map of representation comes from a path between the two points, we don't need any more the quivers there. So you see, it takes somebody who took quiver theory to recognize when we need and when we don't need. So we don't need the quivers anymore. They are a sampling. You know, like if you drive your car at the gas station, the fellow puts a gauge inside your engine to check the oil, yes, in a very concrete way. So the quivers are a way to make your maps into vector space maps, but you don't really need them. So the indecomposables are points, and the maps, the homes, are essential path, and the operation is that you take two essential path that we'll elaborate next time. So this is xi and eta are essential path. And if you put them head to tail, there is no longer essential. So what you do is project eta composed with xi onto essential paths. which corresponds to what in terms of tensoring, and with this, this is the last statement. This one, if here you have K levels, and here you have L levels, yes, it's dot tensor sigma K, yes? Then the next one is dot tensor sigma L. So when you compose them, it's dot tensor sigma K tensor sigma L. But sigma K tensor sigma L for two irreducibles. You project it exactly on the highest weight, yes? So this contains sigma K plus L, according to the Weyl theory. The tensor product of two highest weights contains a unique highest weight. And this is a fundamental mechanism of quivers. And now that we got rid of quivers, this applies to lots and lots of things. Actually, it applies exactly where Hermann Weyl's theory applies. So we're no longer forced to work over SU2, but we can work over SU3, SU4, E8, and so on. And this is exactly the key to doing higher representation theory. Yes, so it was the key was to take quiver theory and get rid of the quivers. Yes, and we won't need the quivers anymore than that remark. This is just for people who happen to have taken quivers. For the others, we'll build the things anyway out of scratch. Yes, this is it.